Hello everyone and welcome. We will review today a process of evaluating BI tools. I would like to ask you to take this concept to any evaluation you do and to use it to lead an evaluation process rather than being led by the vendors. My name is Effie Goldman and I am the Head of Solution Experts in Panorama Software. Today I will speak about the best practices we developed here and my vision of how such a process should be. Let me just skip some marketing slides since I would like to be completely honest and objective. What is a good BI tool? As you can see in my slide, there is no such thing. I also have this evidence from a lot of places. For example, Forrester and Gartner, they also part different BI vendors to different parts of interests like leaders, niche players, visionaries, and challengers. But I'm talking about something more wide. I'm talking about tools that are focused on different arena, different needs. And sometimes some of them are applicable for your needs. Sometimes they are not applicable. They can be the leaders in the Gartner report, for instance, but they are not always maybe half of the time they might not be the ones that you would like to have, at least for your evaluation or for your business. There is place for everyone, of course, but selecting a BI tool is very personal and needs to address especially your specific business case. I also talk about in my presentation about the technical requirements that are also very important, but today most of the tools answer at least 80% or 70% of your technical requirements. There is no news regarding these technical requirements, either it fit or not, but there is a way to handle this as well, and we will talk about it in the next slide. So first come first, and what I would like to discuss is just before we talk about the business case that you need to understand, I want to tell you about the different vendors that are evaluate or that you might evaluate or started evaluating in the BI field. In this case, it can be anywhere or any software that you evaluate. What they would like to do, they would like to guide you on the features that they are best at. I have to admit that I also thought like that in the past, but today, for the last couple of years, I do only what's best for my customer, because I know that if I would not fit for this customer, in the long run, it will not work. It will not work at all. It will not work well, and I will be frustrated. The customer will be frustrated, and the solution will not be a successful solution. And everyone will lose time and effort and lots of efforts to customize things to a place they are not. They're not supposed to be like that. So what you have to understand that they are trying to tell you about features they are best at and to make you think you need these features. For example, they can tell you that you need to download a desktop solution or desktop client since it will be better for your end users. But what if your end users has Mac and their desktop solutions are Windows only? Working on Windows machines only. What about the fact that they will tell you it will be a free of charge service, but if you would like to share it with other people, it will cost you a lot of thousands of dollars, or let's say in some cases it's even more than 200 thousands of dollars if you would like to share it per site license. Now, they don't tell you that, and what I would like to show you today is how you lead the session, how you lead the evaluation, how you listen to their advices, which are sometimes very good advices. They know stuff. They work in this arena for a long time, so they really know what works, what not, what is not working. But so you listen to their advices, but at the same time, you think together with your peers, your colleagues, a consultant that you know, a friend, someone that knows stuff. You think together whether it's a good advice or not. Don't take it as obvious. Don't take these scenarios or the things that they tell you as mandatory. Think big. You lead the evaluation process, and now I will show you how to do that. One other thing is that when you get help from a consultant, make sure he's not get paid from the vendor for the help he's giving you. So sometimes these consultants, and I'm talking about a very good consultants, people that I know of, people that are very kind, but a lot of times they might get paid from other vendors. You have to make sure that at least specifically in this evaluation, he is not getting paid from any vendor. And if he commits to you about that, it means that he will be a very good consultant, and he will help you evaluate the tool that fits for you and not for his commission. So up to now, we just discussed the process. We discussed the things that we need to discover. What happens currently in the when people select a BI tool? What they do usually, they go to the demo session directly, or they create an RFP document, RFI document with lots of technical things inside, and they start evaluate a BI tool. Regarding the technical requirements, regarding the demo that this BI tool is offering, but not regarding what they want, not regarding what they need, not regarding the specific business case. And the first thing you need to evaluate, even before contacting these vendors, is what is your business case, what is the specific scenario, what is the issue that makes your users frustrated. Who are these users? What positions these users are at? What do they do? What my user think about the current solution? Why they're not happy with it? And how they use it? Most importantly, how these users are using this solution? What do they do every day? What do they do every month, every quarter? How they do it? Who they send this information, how they evaluate the data, what their goal is, why they do it this way. A very important question that you need to ask. Why? Okay, I understand that you get into your Excel, which is the same Excel every quarter. You generate the data again, like every quarter. You do some manipulation manually, and then you save it to your business users via Outlook. But why do you do that? And then it can tell you, listen, I'm doing that because my business users would like to see the data refreshed every quarter with regards to the new data. So what you need to offer in this case, for example, as an example, you can offer a solution which will require a tool that will automatically connect to the data and automatically will send the data. But is it really needed? These end users even, do they really need to see all of this data every time? Won't they just, what they're after? What do they want? What do they need? And then you might discover that they need to see only the exceptions, only the things that are not working very well, or maybe the things that are working very well, maybe things that are stuck. If it's sales, we need to know drops of sales. If it's inventory, we need to know if we have enough inventory in different stores, etc. Now, healthcare, number of cases, where, which cases, what happened, what causing it, whether it's a bad treatment, etc. Now, when you discover all of this flow, you can get to a resolution that you need a tool that will do everything automatically. For example, we'll connect to the data, we'll understand whether there are new exceptions in the data, and then send it to these specific business users every month or two, or every day even, if there is an exception we need to know about every day. So you need, it's just a simple example of how to find the right method of work for your users. So it might be something that they don't think about right now, but you can offer them that as a solution. So I knew a very big bank that just printed a lot of reports, and with a marker they went over on these reports and start marking issues that they saw. And then I just offered something very simple. What if I just give you on the screen the issues in a red bulleted and maybe in bold, or different things, or top 10 issues, top 5 issues, a slider that you can select with, etc. And they loved this idea, and we went to provide this solution, although they haven't thought about that. Some of you might use reporting and not analytics. And reporting is good for finance, usually, for different analytics that are more like when you need to get to the actual record of the transaction and you need to see it, which is very well. But if you need an analysis phase, you need something different. So let's go back to the presentation and see that. Understand that we need to find the right method. Now, why do I say that, and why do I emphasize it? Because I haven't contacted the other vendors yet. What I did is just evaluated the product in my environment. I evaluated the product in my business, and without a product. That's the beauty of it. You evaluate a solution without a product that has or doesn't have these doesn't have specific limitations or have such features. We are talking now about a solution that we created out of the blue, and now we will try to understand our technical requirements, the technical things that we are after, that will be part of the solution that we will want to talk about with the different vendors. So when they come to the demo, it will not be the first time that they show us something. It will be the second or the third time that we will review our needs and whether it fits or not. So what I want to bring you is to the fact that, or to the practice of, in the demo itself, get to know your vendors, or get to know the tools that you are evaluating, and you will be able to think whether it's good for you or not, rather than seeing a demo, okay, looks interesting, looks very nice charts, okay, it supplies this and that, okay, now let's evaluate more tools, then you see more demos, then you are frustrated because you are already confused with so much demos that you just saw for 5 to 7 vendors, and then you don't know what to do. So you select somehow a couple of vendors and go to a proof of concept. That's not what we do here. What we do here, we come with the solution and we say whether you can do it or not. Regarding technical requirements, which is something very important as well, we will see for ourselves whether the data that we are using is something this vendor or this tool can connect to. Whether this data that we are using is something that is a limit for that tool. For example, for big data, I wouldn't recommend in-memory tools. I would recommend either direct connectivity to big data or tools that support different OLAP solutions. I would also ask whether it's a customized application. For example, if you need an OEM for a back office, some tools will be able to supply it very easily, some are not. Whether you need a cloud solution or an on-premise solution, usually if you're an enterprise, you will not be able to use a cloud solution because of regulations, etc. But if you are a small medium business, you will be able to use it, and it might be less costly than on-premise solution. Whether you need, if we talk about costs, then it's in another chapter, but whether you need a site license or not, it's only regarding the cost. There are many, many, many issues that you can see here. I will also send you the presentation later. But as you can see, technical requirements can be asked. Now, there are many things that I could have put on this slide, but I put just some of them. And why? That is because that is what I need. These are the questions that I need to ask in order to give my evaluation the best technical answers. You might have other technical requirements. You might have other business case. And what I will do after this session, I will send you a list of a lot of technical requirements. And from this list, I ask you to select only 15 technical requirements that fits your business case and your scenario. Now, why am I talking about only 15 technical requirements and not like in an RFP or RFI, hundreds, sometimes 500, 300 questions, which frustrates both sides? Sometimes you'll get the vendors answering on all of these questions, and they didn't understand what you meant in different questions. You didn't understand what they wrote, but you check it and you get some results which are very, how should I put it, which are very basic. The issue is that you get your vendors off the focus. If you put only 15 technical requirements, they understand that these are the technical requirements that you are after. These are the things that you need to ask, and they need to answer perfectly. Then you get them focused on the things that you are that you need mostly. Now, what I want to say is that you will see later. I think I have it here. Here it is. You will see later the different steps of evaluation are at usually starts with an RFP or an RFI. Then we have the demo session with all of the vendors. Then you decide which one of the vendors goes with you to a proof of concept, which is the POC stage. You spend a couple of days in the proof of concept, and then you go to the final evaluation. Now, final evaluation is the place where you sit with the vendor or with the decision makers as well, and understand whether the tool is good for you or not, see the final presentation, and then you select between yourself what they like and what they didn't like. But usually people are mistaken here, and they just do it by what they see. If the tool is nice, if some technical requirements are answered, if a lot of things that are less maybe are important but less important. What is important is the business scenario. In one of my in one of the evaluations we made, there was a month ago, there was a company that that required us to answer a very long RFP document. We answered this RFP, we went to a demo, then to a POC, and just on the in the end of the POC, we understood something that was not written anywhere. We understood they needed a couple of features such as connecting to ESRI, which was not listed. ESRI is a map service, if you are not familiar with it, and they had it on premise. And it was not listed anywhere. Out of so many technical items and issues that, that were raised, they just forgot a very important deal, which is ESRI on-premise. Now, some of the vendors that were competing me were not aware of it, as I was not aware of it, and were asked about it in the final evaluation stage. That caused them to be dropped after a lot of investment they did in for this customer in this evaluation. Now, what I'm trying to say, this ESRI on-premise thing might sound a bit like off my focus now, but it is in my focus because of all of these technical items, they lost a very significant one. What they liked very much, by the way, is the fact that we created a story and we really understand their business. So try to make your vendors understand your business so they will help you decide. So when you explain the business case, when you explain what they should do, try to tell them why they should do it and how. Now, filling the RFP, RFI, as I said, I would skip it. It will sound weird for some of you, but I would skip it if you are not an enterprise. If you are an enterprise, it is mostly needed and you cannot skip this stage. But what I suggest is that in the demo session, focus on the following things. First of all, what is your goal? In the demo session, after you selected a couple of tools, you never come to the demo session with not knowing your vendor or with not knowing the tool that you evaluate. What I mean by that is that you must spend a couple of hours before the session, a couple of hours, not a couple of minutes. It's a great differentiator between the fact that you know you had something, you read about something, and the fact that you really know how this product is or might work in your environment. So spend these couple of hours, try to download the tool, use it, and understand whether it's easy to be used in the first try or not. Understand or try to figure out how to do some things that you need. Read about this tool. Ask a friend about what it is good at, what it is not good at, whether it gives value to your business case, etc. Now your goal in the demo session itself, when you get to it, is to recognize which tool worth spending the time on a POC. On a proof of concept, which is a very demanding stage. You will spend a lot of money in it. You will spend a lot of days. And you have to understand which tool does not worth it. Now, instead of getting to a demo, as usually people do, and see a product and say, that's a nice product. Wow, how well are the charts and how beautiful the lady that is presenting, or how nice is the self-service. If you lead the session, you set the demo session as you want it to be set. So you say, guys, pleasure to meet you. I would like to present you with our business case. I assure you that they have never had someone talking to them like that in an evaluation. They always come with a standard prepared demo most of the time that they always present to a lot of different companies. You are not the only one that they present to, and they will try to show this standard demo and to talk like they usually talk about their tool. But you stop them. You say, guys, before you start, I would like to present you with my business case and my needs. And then they will listen to you, and then you present it. And then you present the business case that you talked about with the users, and you have the users back for this evaluation process because this solution will fit them. So you'll talk about the user's need, the business case. You'll also talk about the things you need the most regarding the technical requirements. And then you ask the vendor, dear vendor, please show me how you answer these issues. Now, what I want to create is an effect that the vendor will have to show you how he answers these scenarios. Now, he doesn't really have to connect to your data. He doesn't really have to show you that specific scenario on his environment. In many cases or in many presentation that you will have or you will see that these vendors will do the best they can do to satisfy you with your needs, something that they never meant to do just before. Some of the vendors, I must say, will ask you beforehand what your needs are before they start the demo, and notice that these will probably be the vendors that will stick to you through the whole process and might also last after the POC session or POC evaluation session. Because they would like really to understand your business and tell you whether they fit or not, or and how it is done in their tool. So we talked about the demo session. You have to set a demo session with each of these vendors. You have to talk about your business case, etc. What I didn't say is that I suggest you to sit for a couple of minutes just before all of the sessions starts. You need to sit with the decision makers, the people that will join these sessions. And you'll find them very cooperative. Usually, different people would like different things. But first of all, you have to talk with them about the need. You will focus them on what you would like them to see. So instead of seeing nice features and say, wow, how nice it is, or it might be good for us, without even knowing what we need, what you will do in the session that would be just before the vendors come and sit with you all, you will tell them, I would like you to see whether it's good for our business case, and our business case is this and that, and whether the tool is good on the technical side regarding these and that issues. If you do that, I promise you that your evaluation process will be one of the best evaluation processes that happens in your area. Now, after the vendor will show you his demo, see if he answers all of your requirements. You might have some requirements that this vendor does not answer. But when you check these requirements, really think whether these requirements are critical, like a deal breaker, or things that you cannot live without them, or things that are minimal, minor, or just a rumor. For example, if you need self-service on the web, you might even consider self-service which is not only on the web. Just a simple example, and that might open you to more and more evaluations. We go back to the process, and we understand now that we have we are now in stage number two, the demo session. And after the demo session, we get to a very short list of 2 to 3 vendors. In case you are an SMB business, then you probably have 2 vendors. In case you are an enterprise, you probably have 4 vendors that will go with you to the proof of concept. For the proof of concept, I want to talk about 5 minutes, and then you can ask any question you would like about the whole evaluation process, about BI solutions in general, and about anything that regards this session. So just five more minutes. Regarding the proof of concept itself, usually it takes up to a couple of days. It also depends on the number of users that you are going to address with this software. So as much users as you have, the vendor will have bigger interest investing money and people in this proof of concept because he will gain more profit for more users. Try to address in this proof of concept, the most important things that you need, things that are you consider them as critical, because of the fact as in the RFI and the RFP documents, if you talk about a lot of things, they will it will take the vendors out of focus. And if you talk about some things, some issues, then it will give them a very good understanding of what they should concentrate in and what they should do. So what I suggest you to do when you get to a POC, something very simple. Just be there and tell them or guide them on your best or on the things that are most important for you. It can be these 15 issues or criteria or for the technical stuff that you need. It must be the business scenario, the business case. You want to see how it reacts in the environment. For example, if a user needs an analyst to create stuff for him in one tool, and in another tool, a user can do stuff by his own, and in your business case, users can do stuff by their own. They are very technological. They have this capability, and they know Excel very well, let's say, and they would like to do stuff by their own. You want this option for the end user. You don't want an analyst to be in the middle and people to be needing an analyst, because only he can understand how to write a specific code in a specific software. You want the end user to do it. On the other hand, if your users are just viewers, you might even need a dashboard tool and not an analytics tool. So you want to see the business case in that tool, but pay attention to what I say now. When you talk with the vendor and ask him to prepare a specific proof of concept, you talk with him about a guideline. Give him the points of the business case and tell, and for the technical requirements, things that you would like to check, and tell him that these are just guidelines. He can take these guidelines and take them anywhere he would like, as long as he will give you answers for them. For example, in the business scenario I talked with you before, in the proof of concept, they asked specific things. They would like to see a chart. They would like to see how to drill down. they would like to see how different components from different data sources are slicing each other, etc. Some of the vendors just made exactly what they asked for. And we came to the prospect and asked them, guys, can we do something a bit different? Can we show you how it really works in our product with our best practices? And they give us the go, and we created a story. We show them how this scenario can be live on their business case, exactly for their business case. So for example, a manager comes and see a high manager, let's say a CEO, is coming and see his dashboard on a daily basis in the morning, and he sees an issue. He starts analyzing this issue very easily with not much of an analysis, and he understands what is the issue more or less. Then he asks an analyst in the system to talk about this issue, and he just attached this specific user to a specific cell in the data, and then this user will see an email and will start analyzing the data. So this analyst is getting into the data and start meshing up the data and slice and dice the data, get to a result and send an answer. That, for example, is a business case that we show them how it works in our tool, and they were very very happy about this business case, business scenario. But if this specific prospect would have given this option to the other vendors, if they went and said to the other vendors, listen, you can do whatever you want. These are just guidelines. I want to see how it works, best practice in your tool. They might get a different result in the other tools, and then it will be harder for us in this case. So after all of these are done, you spent a couple of days. During these days, very importantly, you were with them, with the development teams. You saw not all the time, but you saw what they were doing, how difficult it was for them, how easy it was for them, what was not very successful, what was whether they had bugs or issues, or things that didn't work well and needed help from a specialist in their company, etc. If you are there and not only seeing the result in the final evaluation session, then you will understand how much effort is needed from this BI tool in the actual day-to-day life and in the actual implementation that you will do. So very importantly, don't just get to the final evaluation and see all of the tools. Be there while they work. Be there, understand what effort is being addressed here or is needed in order to create things in this tool. We will get to the final evaluation stage, which is, of course, understanding which tool gives you the best usability, the best the best solving of your business case, and then you can go on from there and decide with your team which one is the most successful one. When you get to the final evaluation stage, you will have the users. Users back. They will back you up with the decision to go with a specific tool, because this decision will affect the day-to-day life and how they use or consume data in the future. And that was also their suggestion or their initiative to go with you with this tool and because of the scenario that they agreed on in the first place. So see what we did here. First of all, we created a scenario with the business users. They agreed to this scenario. Then we went to evaluate tools that fit this scenario. Then we selected only a couple of tools that we think it fits the best to that scenario, and then we selected them. And that is instead of a regular evaluation that people are doing, that they just see some demos, they decide which one is better, and then they start a POC, they decide which POC is better, mainly on the technical aspects, and then they decide which tool is better for them, mainly on the technical aspects. And we are trying to create a different flow here. We are trying to create a different flow that address the business case much more than the technical aspects, which are also very important, but first comes first. I'm opening the line for questions. I know that we are past the time, but please feel free to ask any question you would like in the chat. I'm here for 15 more minutes just to answer your question. Okay, first question that I got before is regarding if user is more than 3,000 users, then which BI reporting tool will be the best? As I said in the beginning, it doesn't really matter how many users you have. Most of the tools, they fit to the users. It depends on how important it is with regards to the other technical items. Some of the tools will work better with 3,000 users. Some will work less better, or maybe the performance will be less. But it depends on the exact scenario that you have. And if you would like, you can tell me about your scenario, and I'll be happy to help privately. Another question I just received, will I be sharing an RFP document that is used for the evaluation? That's a very good idea. Yes, I will be sharing an RFP document. It's a kind of an RFP document, but I can share something like that, yeah, with all of the attendees of this session. Can my product extract information directly from websites without having to download it first? The specific product we are marketing, Necto, is an in-memory tool. It also supports a direct query for OLAP, but it has to download the data first and then analyze it. It's not a direct connection to different websites. Okay, another question I just got. What is the best practice to assign weightage to each evaluation criteria? That's a very, very interesting question. Let me show you something. I have an evaluation criteria here between, this is something that we got from a consultant that is working with us. This is between Necto, my tool, and ClickView, which is one of our competitors. What we did here, if you would like, I will send it to you. I have other similar things with other competitors, if you like. I can also send you an empty one so you feel it without even using mine. But what we are doing here, we are just giving a score to each one of the issues or the technical issues that might be in the RFP, for example, single web access. Then we say whether it's important for us or not. So, for instance, you can see that there is a column for importance. I can say this one is very important for me. Then, for each one of the tools, you can set whether its availability is exceptional or minimal or just proper. Here in this case, for example, I wrote minimal since they don't support single web access. You need to download a client tool, and everything is written over there. When you fill in all of these pages, or even some, just fill in the ones that you are after, as I said, just the technical requirements that you think that are most required, so you fill in only the ones that are most required, then by a topic, you get a result. Your result here is a score of all of the things that were issued. On the bottom here, you can see how it is being constructed. Okay, if you would like, I can send it to you over a field or not field as you wish. Let me see if there are other questions on the line. Okay, other questions. Interesting. Sometimes it may not be able to quantity all criterias. How do you factor subjective factors into your evaluation? Okay, I do it this way. We have a criteria weight for each one of the topics. So for example, if I go to Unified Access and Connectivity, I see that there is a chapter for access and for connectivity here below. So in the results page, I have the Unified Access and Connectivity, which are different, and I can give them a better weight in the criteria. So if I write 8, for example, in this case, I get a different result here in the pie. So basically what I did, and you can also do it yourself, you can just do or create another column, which will be a category for a couple of criteria. Another question, could you send me the Excel sheet? Yes, of course, I can send you the Excel sheet. I will send this Excel sheet and some more material to all of the people that joined the session. When looking for vendors, how concerned should I be about the size of the vendors? Small to enterprise compared to my company's size. Very, very interesting question, John. I don't think you need to be worried. I think you need to be only worried about the fact that some vendors, they were just started a couple of years ago. They just started with a big investment. I know a vendor that someone just invested in it $30 million. Is it good or bad? I don't know. but the thing is that this vendor is now rising, and people use it. It probably has lots of issues, things that it doesn't do. But for specific business cases, for example, for connecting to some cloud data sources, it does it better than everyone else. So it depends. If you would like, I can help you evaluate other vendors or even our product. Just send me an email and I will do that. I don't know if you all have my email. I'll write it down in the chat box. And for that, if you would like, I can also recommend you, as I said before, I can recommend you of a consultant that is not getting commission from any one of the vendors, and that will be able to help you with evaluating your tool. Okay. By any chance, do you have a comparison for Tableau? Yes, I do have a comparison for Tableau. I will send it over as well. hi, we will get the slides, but will we also get the file you are showing presently? Yes, you will get it. It's the comparisons. Please write me which comparison you are after, and I will give you the solution. Just 1 second, please. Just please hold on a second, guys. I have an electricity issue. 1 second. Oh, made it. Okay, let's continue with your questions. So, other questions. Do you have cost comparisons? I'll tell you what. Regarding cost, people usually give you a discount. So I do have some cost comparisons, but take in mind that, bear in mind that you might get a discount for that. Usually for big companies, you will also be able to see them on their websites. Small companies will less be cooperative on this case. Frank is asking, when to consider cost in the selection process? In the end, I'll tell you what. When you get to just before you get to the POC process, after the demos, then you consider cost. Then you talk about cost because you understand that this vendor might be valid for you for the different costs. And talk about the need, talk about how many users need to have self-service experience, how many users are just viewers, how many users are analysts, how many users are admins. These criteria are very important for the other vendors to understand which one or which price to give you. Another one is asking, do you have cost comparisons across tools? Again, the same question. I will send you some, but still, it might change. And for big companies, just search for it on the web or ask them. But you don't have to do it before. Do it after. After you understand which tools you take for the demo because they are good fit for you, if the demo is going well, then ask for the cost. Don't waste time for it just before. Bilash Dash is asking, do you consider the financial position of the vendor or possibility of getting acquired by another big fish in your evaluation process? That's an important question. I think it's important, but not that important. Yeah, there are a couple of competitors that I know of that all of the time they talk about them, that they are about to be acquired, but it never happens. And you know, they are on the top. These guys are one of the top leaders in the Gartner report, for instance. How should pricing be evaluated across competitors? Again, cost, I was talking about cost just after the demo sessions. All of the demo sessions, you understand which ones you are going to evaluate, and then talk about cost. Be honest with the vendor. Tell him exactly what you need, so you'll get exactly what you need in regards to cost. They can always reduce the price, and it regards the actual users amount. Okay, guys, I also have to leave now for another meeting. Bilash Dash, as I said, the cost comparisons can be done after the demo. After the demo, it is the best place to do the cost comparisons. Okay, guys, I have to leave for another meeting. Thank you very much for joining me today. I will love to send you the material, the different comparisons, and also a video of this evaluation session. Thank you.